Hello everybody, I'm super excited to be here. About just under 2 years ago, I got a telephone call from a man called Cosmo Schaff. It was a strange name and a strange phone call at the beginning. He told me he was going to put together an event in Los Angeles for VR, called VRLA. I went to the first event, it was 100 kids in a playground, and literally their tent. That event has gone on to grow and grow and grow. The next event they have coming up in August is going to have nearly 7,000 people there. So the reason I love to come to events like this is because this is the beginning. And I hope that VR World Congress will grow in the same way that VRLA has. So I'm sometimes asked, what is different about VR this time around? As you can see, I'm a little older. This is not my first rodeo. This is actually the third or fourth time that VR has come around. So why is it different now? Why is AMD investing in it? Well, there are three reasons. The first of all, the technology this time is good. I'm sure that we have all tried it and we know that it's good. What's important is it's going to improve quickly. The second thing that's different this time around is the amount of money that's going into it. Billions of dollars have been invested. And that's important because that money, that cash, is enabling storytellers, content creators, designers, producers, directors, software architects to be able to have the cash to go out and create and improve the technology quickly and create the ecosystem. So it really does feel very, very different this time. So we're excited about that. The other thing that feels really, really different right now is that since the Lumiere brothers' first film in 1895, from that day to this, all of our experiences have been rectangles. Whether you're looking at a silver screen, or you're looking at a television monitor, or indeed a smartphone or a tablet, you're looking at a rectangle. You're the other side of the window. With VR, we step into the cube. That's going to create fresh challenges, but I believe it's going to create an entirely different way of looking at the world. And I think that is tremendously exciting. One of the reasons AMD is behind this, and one of the results of our focus and our efforts have gone into VR, means that this year, 83% of all tethered VR experiences will be driven by AMD. That's very deliberate. We set out to do that. And we set out to do it because we believe in it so much and we're so passionate about it. But let me start now and get into the meat of the presentation. The first thing I want to tell you all today, that I believe that we are at the beginning of what we believe will be an arms race to higher resolutions in VR. The current Oculus headset, 2K per eye, runs at a 90 hertz refresh rate. That's 233 megapixels per second. The PS4 has 120 hertz refresh rate, so it runs around 244 megapixels per second. We have, in our labs, a 4K per eye headset at 120 hertz. It's absolutely astonishingly beautiful. I cannot wait to share it with the world and show you this headset. It is truly remarkable. What's also remarkable is the performance of the headset. Not only is the resolution high, but at 120 hertz, it is a gigapixel per second performance headset. So we're going to see a rush to these higher resolutions. The second thing we're going to see is the introduction of more and more competition into the headset market. A little while ago, I was in China, and I met a VR company with probably the worst name I've ever come across. The name of the company is Deepoon. Actually, it's so bad, I think it's kind of cool. What was astonishing to me about Deepoon's headset is it's actually pretty good. They've already shipped 10,000 of these at $259, and their headset is coming to North America and Western Europe. We're also working very hard with Star VR, who have a wide viewing angle headset we also believe is very, very good. So what's the point I'm making here? The point I'm making here is we're going to see lots and lots of new headset entrants, and the quality is going to be good, and it's going to continue to get faster quickly. So we think that's important. Now, however, Oculus and HTC have their own controllers. How can a headset market emerge unless there are independent controller vendors? Well, the good news is that there are. We believe that Sixth Sense, a company based out of San Francisco, only makes a controller, and the granularity of their experience of their controller is excellent. Now, I don't know if Sixth Sense is yet in Europe. I know that their CEO, Amir Rubin, I think he should be here in Europe, and I'm encouraging him to come here. But I think that what Sixth Sense is doing is going to be to start a controller ecosystem which will match the headset ecosystem. Now, Where we're at today is just the beginning. Somebody asked me recently, if you would compare where we are in VR right now to the video game industry, which I've been a part of my entire life, whereabouts are we in comparison? And I said, we're at Pong. If you look at where we're going and where we are now, we have so far to go. Right now, we're at 2K per eye, around 90 milliseconds and 10 milliseconds of latency. Powering that, you need about 8 teraflops. If you're not technical, let me just tell you, that's equivalent to a $500 or $600 graphics card from ourselves and our competitor. But where do we want to go? We want to get to 144 frames a second at 16K per eye with no latency. That will require something like 743 teraflops of performance. That is 81 times faster than where we are today. What does that mean? I got pretty good job security. It also means we have a lot of work to do, but we will get there. So, but we won't be able to do this any one company by themselves. Although I'm extremely proud of what the teams at AMD have achieved so far, and really delighted about our engagement, we can't do it alone. We believe that success in VR can only be accomplished by working with others. That success in VR will be a rising tide which floats all boats. A little while ago, we helped to form the VR committee, based out of America, with an association called the ITA. A member of my team, Daryl Sartain, reached out to Intel and NVIDIA and Qualcomm and academia and said, why don't we all get together to try and solve some of VR's biggest challenges? I'm pleased to tell you the committee is up and running, and we are collaborating and helping with our competitors, because they also realize that we need to work together to solve some of the biggest problems because of the complexities and the challenges ahead. Now, recently we had an event talking of ecosystems in San Francisco at the Game Developers Conference. And we reached out not only to the headset manufacturers and the games developers, but also to Hollywood and to academia. And these were some of the people that we had at our event. Why am I raising this now? I'm not raising it because I've got a big head and I want to tell you how great AMD are. I'm raising it because there are many of you in the room that we are not engaged with yet. My message to you is this: AMD wants to help. We want to help. We'll help you with samples. We'll maybe help you with funding. We'll help you with technical support. We'll help you in any way that we can. So if you're in the room and you're not currently working with us, then please do come and grab one of us afterwards, because we want to engage with you. Now, the other thing that we want to share today is we believe that VR is going to be about a lot more than consumers. We believe that we're seeing the emergence of what we call VR as a service, or VRAS. Let me explain. We recently got involved with a project with Boeing. Boeing wants to create safety training. And they want it to be as realistic as possible. Well, there's a bit of a problem with creating realistic safety training. It's dangerous. It can hurt people. They realize that with VR, we can get you an environment where we may well frighten you, but won't physically hurt you. There is now an emerging VR industry for safety training. There is an emerging VR industry for real estate planning. And indeed, here in Europe, we saw two announcements recently. BMW is using VR to do car design. And IKEA is using VR to do kitchen design. The reason this is important is that we believe that whether or not consumers embrace VR, and whether or not we manage to, Oculus and HTC manage to ship all the headsets that people want, yes, it matters, but it won't stop these emerging new industries and new markets. And that's very, very exciting to us, and we want to support with it. Now, talking of non-gaming, non-consumer VR, we, a little while ago, made an announcement of a partnership with the Associated Press. I know there's many, many journalists in the room. We think VR in journalism is incredibly exciting, not only for witnessing new experiences, sharing stories in new ways, but also for creating VR. There's not a time enough in this keynote to go through all of that with you now, but again, for all the journalists in the room, if you're not familiar with the deal we did with the Associated Press, we would love to tell you more about it. We also believe that some of the best VR, the most wonderful VR, and let's be clear about something right now. So far today, everything we have in VR is a glimpse. It's a sneak peek into something which we think is exciting. But it doesn't yet exist, VR, which is so compelling, so fantastic, you leave work early to get home so you can get back into it. That you get up early before breakfast so you can use it before you go to work. That kind of VR content doesn't yet exist. For it to come about, we believe that we need to embrace with young content creators. So I'm very pleased to share with you today, we're working with USC in California, with the film school, and with our ICT labs. We're working with Chapman University Film School, with the Beijing Film Academy and Shanghai Film School, here in London, with the University College London, and I believe my colleagues this morning had a meeting with Bristol University. If there's anybody here from academia that's not talking to us today, we also want to talk with you. And we have available hardware, technology, and teaching tools to help you teach the next generation of kids. Now, talking of tools, that leads me to explain, to want to talk to you about Liquid VR. We just had the Games Developer Conference in San Francisco a couple of weeks ago. 1 year before, we announced something called Liquid VR. Liquid VR is a set of software tools to help reduce latency, give you higher frame rates. Now, I think it's interesting to note that just over a year ago, it was impossible to talk about VR without also mentioning motion sickness. Invariably, one led to the other. Today, that's not automatically the case. It doesn't mean we've solved all of the problems. There's still much to do. But we believe that Liquid VR has helped to reduce motion sickness. Liquid VR is available on GitHub. AMD believes that in order for VR to be successful, we need to give you all of the tools possible with source code for free. And I'm pleased to tell you that as a result of that, Liquid VR has been downloaded many thousands and thousands of times and is being used by developers around the world. And if you haven't tried it yet, please do. We also recently announced FireRender, a brand new rendering engine available from us for free. A competitor charges for their version. We believe it should be free. And we are passionate about the importance of giving you free software, free tools with source code so that you can develop as you wish to develop. Because only by allowing you that freedom will we see VR develop at the speed we want it to. Our current GPUs also have something called asynchronous compute. And by the way, if it sounds like a sales pitch, it's going to stop in a second. We've just done some cool stuff. Asynchronous compute is gates on our GPUs, which allow the GPU to do different tasks at the same time. If you try to use the GPU to do physics and compute and rendering without an asynchronous compute engine, it's effectively like trying to rush three cars through a traffic stop at the same time. Sorry, I've been in America too long. Traffic lights at the same time. And so the asynchronous compute allows you to use the GPU for different functions at the same time. We also believe that we have two eyes, so it's very, very important to create VR with multiple GPUs. It can give you faster experience with lower latencies and faster frame rates. And don't take my word for it, at the Games Developer Conference, Valve said that all VR engines should be focused around multiple GPUs. Valve's aperture test, and by the way, is everybody familiar with the aperture test? Can you put your hand up if you know what I'm talking about? Okay, some, not many. Valve put available on Steam something called an aperture test. It's a small test for you to run on your computer to see if your computer can run all of VR. It's a very simple program, and the test will give the results. The work we did with Valve showed that multiple GPUs gives you scaling, so we think that's important too. But the title of the speech is Road to Realism. And so one of the things that people have been asking about recently is what I mean when I talk about the where we are for consumer expectation to where we are with capability. And I believe that this is an important and exciting factor that isn't being talked about so much. Right now, consumer expectation to capability is what I call a one-to-one. And the reason I say that is because most people have not yet got their vibes or got their riffs. So they don't know what to expect. But when they get them, they're going to find out a couple of things. The first thing is, as good as the headsets are, and we salute HTC and Oculus because we think they're excellent, you can see the pixels. And we believe that for some, they don't want to see the pixels. That's an issue, it's a challenge. The other thing is that everybody in this room by now, I'm sure, knows there are two kinds of VR, camera court VR and game engine VR. Game engines have the attraction that you can interact. Cameras have the attraction that the quality is very high. But we're soon going to be asking ourselves, why can't I put the two together? Why are you forcing me to make a decision between VR, which is pretty but I can't move, or I can move but it doesn't look so good? The next challenge that's going to come up is this issue I mentioned of content. Where is the content? And finally, the cost. For a great many of us, VR is still very expensive. Now, what I believe is that we're going to solve these problems pretty quickly. That there is so much demand, the consumers are so excited, and VRAS is growing so fast, we'll solve them. And so in the next 18 months, we'll solve the pixel challenge with 4K headsets. We'll solve the issue on the 360 versus engines by combining them. And we'll solve the issues on content, because I'm in a great position to know about content that's come in, and there's lots of it, and it's really, really good. And we'll also solve the issue with cost as volumes go up. Now, as soon as we get there, we're going to get the next level of expectations. I believe that the first thing we're going to want to do is going to be social. We're going to want lifelike avatars. You know, my mother's in the audience, and she said something to me which I really took on board. She said, you know, in VR, I'm young. And I thought, wow, that's true. I also then realized, you know, in VR, I don't want to look like this. I want to have a six-pack. I want to look fantastic. So I think what's going to happen is that once we realize those things are possible, we're going to want those too. And so all of this is going to combine to create more demand for bigger, more powerful computers, higher resolution headsets, better input controls, and just going to create a fabulous ecosystem. So that's what I mean by expectation. The next thing I want to share with you was a surprise that we had about VR. We were waiting at AMD for Electronic Arts and Ubisoft and Activision and Tencent and Square Enix to produce these fantastic, fabulous AAA games. They're not here yet. That's a little frustrating. I know this is being recorded and it will be on the internet. We're really looking forward to you launching your stuff. But it's interesting to note, Hollywood, on the other hand, hasn't waited. Hollywood has embraced VR wholeheartedly. We've seen the introduction of VR experiences to promote traditional format movies for everything from Paranormal Activity to Interstellar to Jurassic World, and one of my very favorites, The Martian. These VR experiences are creating a new industry, and we're very excited about them. Oh, but I was asked by Ubisoft to mention one thing. They do have a game, and it is so far the best VR game that I've tried. It's really, really excellent. And if you haven't had a chance to try it, or you see it, I encourage you to try Eagle Flight. This is the best game so far. Now let's get back to the entertainment side of things. We believe that these pieces of entertainment VR content deserve a name. So we're calling them VRX, or VR Entertainment Experiences. Now what's interesting is, the companies which are making these experiences are new names. New names to chip makers like ourselves and Intel and our competitor. They're new names to the games industry. The companies that you guys have probably never heard of. The Third Floor, Secret Location, Speculative Theory. These are companies which traditionally were involved with previs. That is, making movie content, using game engines, and now producing VR. We're excited about these companies because they're very gifted storytelling outfits that are going to be able to make new VR and bring out VR to new audiences. So we're very excited about that. But don't take my word for it. I'm going to interrupt my part of the speech by bringing a guest up on stage, my friend Solomon Rogers, to talk about VR entertainment. Please give him a warm welcome. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you guys this morning. Thank you to the VR World Congress for putting on such an amazing event. So, I started Rewind 5 years ago as a visual effects studio, but we've converted fully to be a virtual reality VRX studio. That new terminology is so important to us because it's actually defining a whole type of new mediums. It's not games, films, TV, it's something new, and it needs its own set of, needs its own lexicon, for Pete's sake. But I wanted this. I wanted a holodeck. And I'm amongst friends, and I can say that out loud. And on day one, when we got our DK1, I managed to make it. So a mobile backpack, Razer Hydra in hands, Kinect Studio, and I could walk around my studio and make any reality I wanted. And I knew we could get there somewhat close. So since that point, we've been making VRX content for BBC, for Lexus, for Red Bull, and anyone in between. And I want to show you just a tiny glimpse of the type of stuff that we make. feel free to be loud. The strange thing about that, that all counts as VR. It's from the 360 video to the Unreal Engine and everything in between. And so we need some new terminology. And the main thing is that we need power behind it. And I've been desperate. So I've been very lucky to be working with AMD to try out their new cards and keep pushing as far as we can for the power behind it. So we've had 130, 40 years to do film, and we're really good at it. We've had 40 years to make games, and there's some beautiful stories to be told there. But we've only been doing this current batch of VR for 3 years. If you think about this ridiculous acceleration we've had behind that, it's very intense. And so none of us are experts. I haven't had 10,000 hours of making VR. I'm a specialist because I'm in that area, but only over time are we going to get what we need out of this industry. So VRX should learn from the visual effects industry. It needs to understand everything that's being created, the tools and the talent and everything else. So for us, this is the point where I believe we're really launching. We've got the hardware, finally. We've got the software in the right place. The tools are ready. The talent is coming through, mostly homegrown. But the education, like you say, at degree level, people are going to graduate with a virtual reality degree, and that for us is phenomenal. The new formats of VRX, there's going to be things like this. I want to drive around, drive a DeLorean, punch Biff in the face, and then be part of Back to the Future. Or in Sleep No More. So I'm immersed in an immersive theatre for 3 hours, or as long as I want, to see this unfolding world in front of me. The final thing I briefly, Roy allowed me to put this in here, we started a thing called VRTogether.org, which is to create non-commercially viable projects in VR. So VR for good. We all know that it can help with post-traumatic stress. It's being used in American universities to treat burns victims. But if anyone who's a VR creator would like to volunteer for this, we volunteer time. And anyone who has a good idea in this audience who thinks it should be made, puts it on there. And we just connect people together. Thank you very much. The VRX industry and VR World Congress is actually a starting point, I believe, for a whole new industry. And thank you, Roy.
Okay, last year we worked together with Matter VR, based out of Santa Monica, and with a very talented pair of gentlemen, Corey Strasburger and a creamer from Kite and Lightning, who I was delighted to find are here today, to commission two VR projects. The first project was with the Smithsonian around about the Wright Brothers flight. And the second project we put together was called Neuro, the one with Kite and Lightning, which was an exploration of the brain, the synapses, whilst listening to electronic dance music, which we worked on together with General Electric. AMD is going to make both of these experiences available for free to anybody to download as examples of terrific VR and as examples of how VR can be used for education, and VR can also be used for science and medicine. So we'll be posting those shortly. We're also working with the camera manufacturers, with Jaunt, Nokia, and with GoPro. Now you might wonder, how is a GPU used for camera 360 called VR? The answer is that with the more cameras you have, the more images you have to stitch together. And we believe that we've created some of the best stitching hardware and software in the industry. And those tools are going to be made available. Now, I talked earlier about the importance, the need to put together camera core assets for VR together with game engine assets. We got together with a young director in Hollywood called Kevin Cornish to try and see how that would work. The experiment was successful. The VR experience is good. But the amount of data that it needed was incredible. 2 minutes of content created more than 20 gigabytes of data. So we're excited about where this has to go, but we got some things, some problems that we need to solve in order to bring those two worlds together. Part of doing that, we believe, will be working very closely in light fields. Now, can you, I'm going to have to do this one last time. Can you put your hand up if you know what a light field is? Okay, that's good. Very good. The light fields, we believe, are going to be absolutely essential to capture realistic humans and be able to put them as avatars or as ourselves into VR. We are working with Dr. Paul Dubevic at USC ICT in America in light fields. We are very interested to talk to anybody in this room, you or your colleagues or anybody you know that's working in light fields, because we believe they're absolutely crucial to the future success of VR. Now, the other thing we think is really crucial to VR is going to be audio. And here's an observation that I think you might find interesting. When a filmmaker puts together a piece of content today, he has to recognize that the nearest placement of audio to the viewer cannot be closer than 100 to 200 feet away. And the reason for that is that most film experiences are enjoyed in a cinema, and they have to be designed and built for that. With VR, we can get you audio placement to within 5 centimeters. Imagine, if you will, for example, you went into an elevator, the door shut, and the light went off, and suddenly right over your shoulder, a voice says, "Good evening." We think it would scare you to death. We think that it brings a number of new possibilities. AMD is working to accelerate audio in VR, and we'll have updates on that work for you very soon. Now, I mentioned to you about tools. I'm pleased to tell you that next week, so I'm giving you a sneak preview, next week at the NAB show in Las Vegas, we're going to announce a new professional graphics card, the AMD Fire Pro W9100 with 32 gigabytes of RAM. We believe that to try and put these pieces together with these very large data sets, you're going to need a graphics card that has these kind of size frame buffers. We also announced recently the Radeon Pro Duo, which is a dual GPU card to allow you to produce VR content optimized for dual GPUs. We also announced a program called VR Ready Premium so that consumers can identify the content that's been made this way. But you know what, I feel like I'm plugging AMD a little bit too much. So let me go to my last slide on this morning's keynote. I talked to you a little bit about entertainment, and I talked to you about some of the things we're doing. We announced at the GDC event a deal together with 20th Century Fox and Ubisoft to help create a VR experience for Assassin's Creed the movie, which comes out this fall. We're really, really excited about this partnership. It combines everything I've talked to you about today. It combines liquid VR, it combines the use of 360 cameras, it combines VRX, and it combines the games industry together with the movie industry. We're very, very excited to do this. But look, I'm a Brit. I'm here in Britain with a British audience. As much as I love living in Hollywood and working with Hollywood, I would be thrilled and delighted to work on a British project for television or entertainment or in any other medium where we could create the same kind of partnership. So thank you very much for listening to me and for giving me your time. Sorry we're late. We're opening up for questions.